society then.
Yeah. Hello, everyone.
Time to do some server-side web programming again.
Yeah.
This is the second to last lecture in the course.
It's the last lecture.
Yeah, or live lecture.
Yeah. Then the last one will be kind of more resources to read up and some pre-recorded demos.
Quite a lot, I heard.
Yeah, well, 3 or 4.
And a lot of reading to do as well. And that is for the last peer instruction and the last examination and the last assignment. So
exactly. It's about putting your application on a production server and what to think about that and stuff. Mm. But today we're going to talk about
real-time web.
Yeah.
And real-time web applications. And this is the intro for the third assignment as well. Because this is what you're supposed to do in the third assignment, to write a real-time web application.
Yeah.
So let's have a look of what to do today. So we will have some kind of introduction to real-time web applications. We will look at some technologies and especially make this journey once again from how it's been to where we are today regarding those techniques, because you have been able to write real-time applications for quite a long time, but it wasn't so easy before.
Well, we have the HTTP protocol, and it's not built in, but there were always some hacks around it to get a real-time feeling for web application, and that's what we're focusing on.
Yeah, so we will look at different technologies for doing different tasks in the browser when it comes down to real-time applications. We will squeeze in a demo, short demo in the end, I hope. We want to be out of here like 5 minutes early today, because the Swedish Royal Air Force is doing a big flyover for celebrating the annual celebration of their existence, basically. So we will end a couple of minutes early. So we will speed it up, but I think we will be able to squeeze in the demo as well.
Yeah.
So let's get down to business and defining real-time.
Yeah, put it web in a context through stuff. So wall of text.
Wall of text.
Yeah.
So this is a definition that you wrote.
And I find some inspiration on the Wikipedia.
But the thing is, we want data to as fast as possible go to the client. We want the client to be updated with data in so short time as possible.
Yeah, after the data is changed or created. And we want to do that without any need to additional request, because we have the HTTP architecture with the request response, but in real time we really just want one request and getting the server to push out the data all along, so the client just listens to these changes in the data.
And we will look at some examples later on, but just to get an image, it could be real-time gaming, it could be like showing graphs for stock exchange, it could be messages, it could be everything that is need to be up to date, notifications, real-time messaging, whatever. But what do you mean by a short time? You have three definitions, and this is taken from more real-time. Real-time application has existed long before web applications.
Yeah, and we've got to remember that we are building web applications. So when you talk about real-time programming and stuff like that, maybe that's not in a web environment. We have an unsecure network between the client and the server. So real-time or a short time in real-time can mean different things depending on what context you talk about it. And when we were looking at the Wikipedia definition, they had these three hard, firm and soft categories.
Where hard being really hard to implement on the web.
Because you have your unsecure network, the internet or the web.
Yeah.
And we can't be sure that we get the traffic. Something can happen in between. Yep. We cannot control that in that case.
No. So maybe we will not live up too hard. I mean, I think you in another case described this as brakes on the car.
Exactly.
You need a backup and you need it to happen when you press the brake.
You can't
not, have, not 2 seconds later.
Yeah, because that will fail your...
Yeah. However, completely. Firm and soft times, firm being that, okay, so you can miss some deadlines, but it will still, the system will still work and
recover.
Yeah,
of course, we will lose some data maybe, but it's the usefulness of the result is zero after the deadline, but the service can still work dependent of if we miss some. Kind of results.
Yeah. So an example could be a game, for instance, where you get the position of the opposite player. And okay, so if you miss a couple of updates, it will probably result in the client needing to what's the English word? Interpolate the movement for that player. So okay, it was moving in this direction. No, we're not getting updates anymore, so it will continue to move that, and after a second it might get new updates and it will be able to
and the game will correct the crash, but you get some lagging.
And then the soft times, I mean...
Yeah, we're not so dependent, we can use the result...
Even though it's
after its deadline, so to say.
Chat applications.
Yeah. Well, it will be degrading the quality of system. Since if it's 3 seconds after the user wrote the message, the chat will still work and the message will come through and it will be useful.
Yeah.
But it's greater to have a chat system where you get responses directly.
Yeah. And when talking about real-time applications, we will also see that, the typical case we will work with is maybe just one-to-one communication, peer-to-peer communication between the client and the server, for instance. But, I mean, we should think of this in a broader way, looking at broadcasts as well, that the server is broadcasting messages to a lot of clients listening.
Yeah. Think of a chat with more people, and one is writing something, and it will be broadcasted to all the clients.
To all the ones listening, And you have, I mean, for those of you who took the preceding course, you wrote this chat using WebSockets, and you implemented that kind of real-time web application without writing the server, and we will focus on the server in this course, of course. Mm. There are many, many, many techniques for achieving this on the web today, and a lot of hacks, as you wrote, because many of those techniques are like struggling to get past the limitations of the HTTP protocol.
We have to do some hacking to get around this request response, the server not able to push data to the client and stuff. Yeah. And we're going to look at some old used techniques for this.
And as you've written, this was not the way the web was intended, and we talked about that.
The request response model is very good for just getting the page, letting the server responding out the page, and then forget about being able to take many more requests. Mm. So that was the point with the request response and HTTP.
And looking at modern web applications today, you could probably identify more or less each and every one you use today, and you will find real-time components within the application, even if the application might feel like it's a pretty static one. You will probably find real-time elements everywhere on the application. And we will have a look at some examples. So we've already spoken about web-based games.
Mm-hmm.
And if we look at many of the popular modern web browser games today, I mean, they take use of this real-time component. I've already mentioned games like Augur.io, Slither.io, and
yeah, you whatever, know, that, no more that, me. Than
yeah,
me
that those case. Kinds of games are yeah. using real-time communication over the web. Yeah. So it's not perfect, but I mean, those games work pretty, pretty well. As
and
long
you
as
get
you have
the
a stable
multiplayer
yeah, yeah.
thing working.
Yeah. yeah. Other types of services, of course, social communication, that's yeah. an obvious one with the chats and live comments and feeds and yeah. and notifications.
Yeah.
Because that is...
That's a very common way, because we will probably more and more use the web as we will use things in our handheld devices like the phones and stuff, and there we have lots of notification stuff going on. And as you see in this screenshot, that's the Twitter, so it has some kind of okay of showing the tweets that I have when I visit the page, and then have some real time getting all the new tweets, and we can see view 15 new tweets there. Hmm. So that's one way we have to build our web application as real-time.
Yeah. Oh, Tottenham. Was it a good weekend for you?
No, it wasn't. Continue.
Okay. so other application collaboration tools is, of course, one kind of applications as
yeah.
well, where you I mean, you have might have many users editing the same document. You will also, I mean, maybe the real-time communication is the easy part in those kinds of applications. It's the hard part is synchronizing and managing if data get old and those kind of things. The real-time communication on the web today, those protocols, as you will see, so simple to use. So that shouldn't be a big problem. Yeah, you've written the second screen experience as well, being
a term you talk about and hear a lot about, having, okay, we experience something on our TV or whatever, and having a second screen, the handheld devices where you have applications or data streaming to expand the experience of the first screen.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And being able to sync those experiences.
Yeah.
I mean, there is a lot of interesting problems arising when doing this, but it also makes, I mean, the web more interesting. It makes
you can think about all the kind of applications you can write with this and new kinds of way of experience stuff. And you have all used the peer instructions, for example, as a real-time application where we do our votes and
augment the lectures more.
Yeah,
by,
exactly.
By adding.
And
this,
it's a second screen experience because we are the first screen.
Now this Deutsche Qualitäts system doesn't work that well every time.
Well,
but
it's pretty good. Yeah.
It's pretty good.
If if you post the right URL, it will work pretty good.
Point taken. Decision making is also, I mean, if you can depend on the data that you get, and then it's important that the data is not too old, because you're depending on this for trading or
things where you want the data fast and see what's happening in real time for making decisions, getting the right information as fast as possible to make, well, different kind of decisions, whatever it may be. Monitoring your application, seeing that everything works as it should, the servers are online and stuff like that could be a very good real-time web application to have, and there are several of those.
Yeah, and this is what we will probably focus a little bit more on. Maybe not in those courses, but I mean, we have the other program, the what's it called? Development and I'm not sure what.
No, not on English. UDM program.
The DevOps program in Kalmar that will focus on those kinds of applications in more detail, but
using them, not writing.
No,
them.
But yeah, and maybe using them in a richer way, connecting them together.
And this is just a short list of things you will count in as web real time web application. Of course, there are many more, and hopefully you get some ideas developing these kind of applications where it fits very well with these techniques we're gonna talk about.
Yeah. So I guess we could ask ourselves if this is a change of paradigm.
Yeah. Because when you have a course like this for 5 years, you probably wasn't talking about real-time web application. But as we said, nowadays we are using our phones and stuff and trying to get a whole of writing web applications for these kinds of thing. We were talking about notification, and we probably expect our applications to give us notifications if we have some data streaming or stuff like that. So
instead of looking and actively searching for the information, we want the information
when it happens. We won't do the reload the page or stuff like that to see things happening. We want the application to notify us.
Yeah, and we could have the Web of Things or Internet of Things. As an example, I wrote a new tumble dryer, and it's connected.
Okay.
But I mean, the only thing I'm really interested in is getting a notification when the tumbling process is finished. Mm. Even though I could remote start it, but I don't. So I think notifications will be. I mean, it will be important. And you will need to be able to handle them in each and every web application, more or less.
Yeah, and just the Web of Things, you have these kind of devices and you want the data in real time because some are sensors or stuff like that that gets a lot of data and you want to handle that in real time.
And you can set trigger values when the sensor is over this value, you should broadcast this message and other units will listen and take action upon those events. We have discussed e-business as well, which is, I think it's a pretty new area, or a couple of years, maybe that. I mean, if you have a e-business today selling something that is selling something that people want to buy, and there you have, what's the English word of concurrent?
Concurrents. Or competition.
Competition in businesses.
Yeah.
You need to stay ahead all the time, and being able to get data and know things about your opponents will get you on top. So for instance, if you are selling a product A, and other web shops are selling this product as well, but you see that those other web shops, they run out of stock.
Okay.
Then maybe you could adjust the price. Yeah. You could like always be one unit below in price, and you can like work with the price in a really, really dynamic way instead of, I mean, back in the days when you changed the price of a product maybe on a weekly basis or something like that, going on to the first websites where you changed it maybe daily, but often a manual work had to be done, going into automizing this and being able to change the price several hundred times a day. Yeah. If someone writes an article on Facebook, for instance, mentioning your product, you would probably want to adjust the price. Because you will get selling more units, so I mean there is a lot of
I think they are
economics.
They were interesting in looking at these kind of things and handling real time data for these kind of things.
Real time APIs and streaming APIs. We will look at. Will we look at that?
No, well, not the streaming APIs. It's more okay. You get the Twitter stream or whatever the feed, getting a lot of data coming, and that's why we mention it. Okay, we're gonna talk about web APIs or use it in the assignment, and that's the more request response, getting the data. There are some real time API or streaming API where you can listen to events and stuff like that. We will look at the webhook thing. That's kind of that, but this is more pushing data out in a stream all the way, and you listen to it and use it in some kind of way.
Mm. So, looking ahead, what will we do in this assignment that is connected to this?
The last and third assignment, it should be published onto the course webpage, and it's gonna be about this real-time thingy. We're gonna let you are all using GitHub, and you have your third exam assignment repo. So you're going to use that and get notifications from GitHub whenever an issue is happening on that. So you're going to use something we call webhooks. We're going to come back to that. You're also going to use request data from the GitHub web API. More, that's not the real time, so that's more request response thing. So you're going to do it when you start the application. Then you're going to listen to these webhooks. Mm. We're going to, as I said, talk about it. And you're going to create a WebSocket server that sends out this real-time data. So whenever a user is writing an issue on your repository, your web client should get that notification and in real-time as fast as possible.
Mm. And I think it's a really exciting exercise because, I mean, If you have done this flow of an application, you will probably see a lot of possibilities opening up, because many of the tools that you use on the web today have some kind of support for hooks or an API that you could use, and being able to start connecting things together. So when this happens, you could do this or that. Will be really, really interesting.
Yeah.
But we will look at the hooks thing.
Exactly. In just a moment. We hope you get some ideas, so then maybe you also implement some own features or stuff like that. I think the requirement is just this we talked about, and hopefully it will be. Well, I shouldn't say easy to implement. It's always dangerous to say, but as you see, the techniques for it is pretty simple. So,
and I mean, we talked about notifications before. We haven't looked in the client. We haven't looked at the notifications API.
No, that's
you know,
one
this
thing.
One getting some kind of if you can see my pointer on the mouse, getting some kind of notification above us, you know, coming in from the side saying, oh, this posted a message on Facebook or whatever. But that's really, really...
That's more a browser API.
Yeah, it's a browser API that is connected and talking to the underlying operating system. Yeah. And I mean, extending this assignment with that kind of notifications, for instance, would be an interesting addition, and quite an easy one as well, I think. So try to explore different techniques. Don't just make our requirements work. Please add some own things. You have the, as we have said before, this course is 2 weeks longer than the Kalmar version. That will be in the spring. So you have a good amount of time over the Christmas to extend upon this assignment, and I think that would be interesting as well. The last point.
It's a point to and then this application you create, you should also put on in production, so to say. So you had to publish it somewhere, and that's the next part in this course, the resource part. We have you get a lot of information about that.
And for instance, maybe we have a link to that later on, but DigitalOcean and
we're gonna I think it's in the next
part. Lecture. But you will get information on where to be able to put
you
this
don't in. If you don't have a web server or stuff like that, you are able to get accounts through this GitHub education pack, but that would be
either
more
on DigitalOcean or Amazon, or
wherever
you like to put this application.
Yeah,
yeah. So that's the assignment. It's published on the course webpage.
Yeah,
so
it should be.
Yeah, you can start whenever you feel like you're ready to go. So we will segue over to the technologies to use. So we will probably go back in time a little bit and look at those kind of older techniques that are quite commonly used still today.
Yeah.
And we will present them, and then we will have a look at WebSockets. That is the a solution to a lot of things, and something that you have already used in other courses as well. So,
but we will try to explain why WebSockets will be there.
Yeah. So, you probably know this, but the problem with HTTP is that you need this kind of polling of data. You need to, from the client, you need to make an initial connection, get a first response with all the data, and then you have to ask the web server continuously over and over again for new data, and the web server is have to take time, basically, to answer you. So every request needs an answer, and that will stress the client, and it will definitely stress the server if you have a big community.
A lot of requests just asking for stuff that hasn't happened.
Yeah.
So we miss the ability for the server to tell the client when it has new data.
Yeah.
So it can push data. And that's the problem with HTTP in this case.
Mm.
Of course, we have the request response architecture.
So, but, I mean, HTTP, we're going back to the 90s.
Mm.
And writing real-time applications had, I mean, already in the 90s, you wanted to do this.
Yeah, of course. You wanted to write applications as you did in the desktop, having the same ability. So, but to get around this, we have to use some kind of plug-in technology.
Yeah, so those awoke quite early, being Java applets was there really, really early, and this was, as I mentioned before, was a contester to be JavaScript, JavaScript in the browser. So instead of JavaScript, many people wanted Java instead with Java applets. But this was like just adding a plugin to the browser.
You must have the virtual machine
running, and it was quite heavy back then.
Yeah, and
security issues. Yeah. It wasn't built for the web in mind, so it was more or less a hack upon the browser. So, but in Java applets, you could do the streaming over TCP.
You could do a lot more than you could have some TCP sockets just communicating. You could look away from the HTTP problem and set up raw sockets and push data that way.
Yeah. And it was a really long time since I wrote a Java applet, but I think you could communicate between like JavaScript and the Java applet, right? So you could use the Java applet as a communication layer for...
I think that was the implementation of the plugin in the browser, and you have some bridge over that.
Yeah.
In some kind of, in the Flash platform, that was, you were able to do that anyway.
Because Flash was the next big revolution on the web, being this plugin that could do things that we weren't able to do in the browser, like streaming movies and streaming things.
First of all, it was a design tool, I think, because you could use the vector graphic stuff, and all the designers liked it. And but it's always also a plugin stuff, and that's one big problem.
Yeah.
But the Flash platform, as you said, they have the ability to stream videos and stuff like that, and they had some special protocol, RTMP, real-time message protocol, I think it was called. And they had, you could had servers just handling these kind of things. And it, we have written...
shared objects.
Shared objects, you could use, like, manipulating an object on its server, and it reflected out to everyone listening to that object. And it's just as Java applets, it solved this kind of problem.
Yeah, and probably quite used still today, even though Flash as a technique is really on the...
I don't know. I think you see a lot of Flash games or...
Yeah, probably.
Yeah. I think it still... But it's going down.
Yeah. So since browser after browser is banning Flash.
But as I always say, you can make jokes about the Flash or the Java and stuff like that. But one thing you have to remember is that these kind of platforms showed us how we wanted to use the web. Because we want to see videos on the web. The YouTube was using the Flash platform.
Yeah.
Or maybe, still in some places.
Yeah, you could probably use Flash.
And that shows this kind of, in the platforms, you could do so much thing and people being creative and using it for different kind of applications or services. And the HTML standardization took very long time and they didn't go try to involve these techniques, but... these platforms showed us
what we want to do.
And kicked them in the butt to start working on these kind of things, and that's a good thing. And but then we have the plugin stuff that we don't want to use that anymore.
No, and we have Silverlight as this the most typical example of this, and you have called it tvåa på bollen när matchen är second on the ball when the match is over.
Yeah, they come in pretty late, and I think they put a lot of resources on the Silverlight.
Yeah.
One and a half year maybe.
Yeah. And the latest version is 5, I think it's since 2011.
Yeah, they have put it up. But the Silverlight was intended as a pure media server. They wanted to get the streaming video stuff, and they had their, all the movie companies wanted the digital right management in some kind of way, so you couldn't download the video through the web application and stuff like that. And I put a lot of work into that and make it a good product. And then, they were going to do a lot of more, just like a competitor to Flash in that time.
Yeah.
But it's still used in some cases as a media server, but I haven't installed a Silverlight plugin in many years.
No. I hope I will not ever need to do that again. Yeah. So this is the history of plugins, more or less.
Yeah, but we want to...
Yeah, today you could say that, I mean, it's native technologies that rule most of this kind of applications.
So we're going to concentrate on HTML and JavaScript techniques.
So Comet. Comet is a technology that you hear a lot about, and Comet is actually a umbrella term for different technologies in the browser for solving this problem.
Yeah, hacking the this
HTTP problems.
Yeah, exactly.
Getting around them, and it's all started with HTTP 1.1 spec, where you got the possibility to hold the connection.
Yeah, sending more than one request during the same TCP connection. So I think the browser could have up to 8 or something. And that's the problem. So we have mentioned the domain sharding technique. So you had a subdomain and you could open 8 more, and you could stress the client to use more open HTTP connections for using these techniques we're going to look at.
Mm. We have this, I mean, this was also a possibility. We haven't talked about iframes or frames in particular, but an iframe is just an element you embed on your HTML page, and that element is a window object in its own. So you get a web page inside of your web page, and if you do this right and they are from the same domain, those frames can communicate. So the mainframe can communicate with iframe, and by this iframe could have code that the only responsibility for that code is to make connections to the server and get new data, and when it does, it could send this data back to the main window. So that was a technique quite commonly used to manage this kind of problems.
Okay. I don't think you see it too much today.
You shouldn't. No. I guess. XHR long polling we will go into detail.
Yeah, we're going to show a picture.
Basically, just holding a connection open over XHR.
Uses this Ajax way of asking for data.
Yeah, and streaming is a variant on that one. Mm. Something that came with HTML5 is service and events. You have a link behind me, I guess, so remind me. Service and events are supposed to, it's more or less events that emit on the server and pushes the data to the client. Okay. So the client can listen for events from the server. Now, this is an HTML5 or it's a V3C spec, but it hasn't been implemented in Edge yet.
I think they say under consideration.
Yes,
still.
And
they have done for a couple of years.
Yeah, so
I think it's full supported over the other browsers. Yeah.
But since it's not in Edge, I mean, it's hard to say when this will be really used, but probably like now you can use this in conjunction with another technique doing a similar thing. But I haven't written anything, and I know you haven't.
No,
well,
I haven't used it. I have read this article with the link, so you can check it up there.
Yeah. So the probably most common technique when it comes to real-time is WebSockets, and we will talk about those as well. So starting off with the XHR polling.
Yeah, we're just going to explain how it worked, yeah.
Yeah, so this being the client and this being the server, what happens is that the client is doing a regular XHR connection against the server.
With the connection keep alive as was implemented in this HTTP 1.1.
Yeah. And when the server gets this message, it will look, do I have any new data? If I don't, I will just sleep or kind of delay the response or the timeout or whatever.
It won't send a response, so it will hold up this request and we can call it sleep on the server in one way. So
and
it will go a couple of seconds or 10 seconds or whatever.
So after a while, it will wake this thread up and it will pull the database or whatever again.
See if any other kinds of data have coming into the database in this case. But.
Or get an event that says, now we have new data, and react upon that event with a queue. Or however you want to implement this. But the important thing is when you get the new data, you send it back and you close the request.
Yeah, the implementation of this will be what kind of platform or server are you? Are you using Apache PHP with the threaded variant? Are you using Node? Are you using a special Comet server, which is optimized for these kind of things?
So, if you're doing this using an Apache with threads, you will, as you see, get a lot of open threads that you need to sleep those threads and could be quite resource heavy if you have a lot of calls to your server. Yeah. Doing this in Node, you would probably just add a lot of events, and then when those trigger, you will just add them to the queue. So it will be probably a little bit easier to write this in Node than in a PHP server, or optimized anyways. And then when the data has been sent back, the client will have to do this all over again. So it will send a new request with an open connection.
Because in this case, we get some data because we had or we get a timeout from the server because we have a timeout set on the server holding this connection. Mm. And directly when the clients get this, it's maybe get some data and show it to the user or whatever. But the main thing is it's open up the same connection directly. So it's simulating having a long connection, but it's not optimized since we have to open new connections
all the time.
So that's the hack. Try to simulate having a, it will, for the user, it will look as we have a real-time socket open or like that.
Yeah. And looking ahead, we have this term of XHR streaming as well, and it's a similar technique with the difference that instead of the client needing to do new connections all the time, we could send a chunk of data that is not a complete response, but partly a response, and make the client react upon that, and then we will do this a couple
so of times. It will always wait to the timeout, you could say, cause you maybe could send some chunk data a couple of times before the connection need to be closed down and open again. And you have to look at the ready state over two, and you get this. And this is the transfer encoding chunked ability also in HTTP 1.1, I think it was introduced. So it's a little optimizing. You don't close the connection as fast you get some data. So it will work better in more data intensive applications.
But either than one of those techniques is still, as we can see, a hack, more or less, just to get around the limitations of the HTTP. It's cumbersome to work with, both on the client, because you need to do these connections over and over, on the server, because you will need to remember state of every thread that you handle. Of course, there are libraries helping you doing this, of course, but it's still not an optimal way of working with real-time data.
Yeah, and as I said, there will be this comment is there were special server software optimizing for this and clients libraries to this, and it's important to know we're gonna go and talk to about WebSockets, but these kind of techniques is. If you look at the library we're gonna suppose maybe use in the website, they have these kind of techniques as a fallback.
If
the browser doesn't support the WebSocket or the WebSocket server is down, they fall back into these kind of techniques. And that's important to know.
And as we looked upon this morning, preparing for this lecture, we had a look at the Facebook chat, for instance, and that was using long polling as a technique for synchronizing the chat. So even Facebook and the Facebook Messenger chat that is really, really commonly used, still using this kind of polling technique instead of WebSockets. Why, I don't know, but I guess it's a big process to change something that actually works pretty well, because this technique works for chat, it's no problem.
And they probably have the ability to have specialized servers for that kind of thing, so that's not the problem for them.
Yeah, but for us, being able to choose our own technology when doing the assignment, we will of course probably choose WebSockets because it's so much easier to work with, less of things you need to think about.
Yeah, and it will be the future, I think.
Yeah, and the protocol optimized for doing this kind of transactions with text or binary. So what is sockets, first of all? I mean, sockets, I think it's a term back from the Unix systems where you were treating everything as a file, even network connections were files in a way which you could read and write and open. And you call those endpoint sockets. That is a term that's been around real long time for kind of a funnel connection.
When you talk about this transport protocol on the transport layer, they open up sockets and ports and stuff like that. So TCP socket is a, and that's why it's called WebSocket because it worked the same way.
And as you probably know, since lectures before, you make the connection over HTTP, and then you make a protocol change, and you might upgrade to, or you make an upgrade to the WebSocket protocol, and you can do this over SSL or TSL if you like.
And that's a good thing, because you're gonna use the port 80 and 443. So often when you use sockets and stuff like that, you have to open up a specific port, and you have to fight with the ops people who doesn't want to open up in the web proxies or firewalls and stuff like that. But this is going the same port as HTTP.
So you will probably not. I mean, if the web page works, WebSocket will probably work as long as the browser supports WebSocket. But as we have seen before, the browser support is really good today. That's an important thing to remember, that it is the regular ports that is used. We have a two-way communication for duplex, so we could send and receive data.
Yeah, and we can also send not just text, we can also use binary data to, yeah. to be more optimized in sending stuff.
Yeah. It's a standard from the Internet Engineering Task Force, RFC 6455. So if
you get inside and read.
Yeah, with a good whiskey and a Friday afternoon, you can sit and look at in this spec if you like. It's been around for a while. Was quite hard to implement WebSockets in the beginning because the browsers weren't supporting the same APIs. They were quite different, but today it's really well defined by the V3C and all major browsers are supporting the same API.
And I think all of you have used that API if you took the
preceding course.
Yeah, exactly. So that's on the client, and this standard is for the server, the other one.
Something to remember when it comes to WebSockets is that the normal security mechanisms are in place that we are used to. However, not the same site origin policies that we could end up with trouble with when using XHR, that you cannot communicate to another server, for instance, if that server hasn't set its course headers in a correct way. However, so in this case, you can communicate with a different service, but you should probably use the CSP that we talked about on the peer instruction last time, so the content security policy, so that you could define to what servers your application should be able to communicate. Because as we said, if you get bad code running on your client, it will be able to communicate with WebSockets to another server. So by setting the CSP, you can prevent that, so that the application will only talk to the servers that are validated by you. Did we get a question?
Yeah, we have two questions. Is there a way to push a notification to the client somehow, even if the client is currently viewing another web page?
Yeah, so this is quite interesting. So the notification API in the client is only a simple API showing notifications. So to be able to show notifications from the service, you need to add something that gets the message from the server, for instance, using WebSockets. So you get the message and you show it to the user. However, if the user is not on your page, if you close down your application, of course your code will not run in a normal web application. You will not have a connection using WebSockets to the server. However, this is where service workers come as a really interesting technique, because you can install a service worker into the browser, and this service worker will kind of be in the background and sleeping, probably being shut down, and with I'm not entirely sure how to do this because I haven't had time to try it out, but you could, by using some kind of server push technique, wake up that service worker with a message, and that service worker could use the notification API to show a notification for the user even if the user is not visiting your page. And you have probably seen this for the last couple of months. It's been Facebook, LinkedIn, and all of those services have probably asked you if you want notifications from their applications, even if you're not connected or have that application running in your browser. This is service workers doing the job for you. So if you go into the browser in the web development tool, go over to, resources, where you find the local storage and session storage, you will find a service worker tab, and there you could have a look at what service workers are currently installed in your browser, and those service workers actually being able to run code even though you're not visiting that specific application. Yeah, so you can do that today.
Yeah. We have another question about HTTP2, where they talk about that WebSockets is kind of hacky, and that HTTP2 hopefully will solve that. I think what I know about HTTP2 was that they discussed implementing a more server push way. They have something called server push, but that's not with this. It's more telling that reading off the, like say, an index page, and you see, okay, you're gonna need this style sheet and this JavaScript, so the server can decide that it will push out it without getting a request. I think they abandoned the idea to implement some kind of WebSocket thing and rely on the WebSocket protocol for it.
But I mean, if you just go back, and I'm not sure what the state was on that video, because if you go back like 2 years, it was quite cumbersome to work with WebSockets, it felt like a hack.
Yeah, and sometimes in different, because this standard is pretty unmature, so there have been some on the server implementation where people are trying to use this standard, and it's pretty young, and they you have an old version of that, and it won't work with newer browsers, and it's been pretty much a problem with this kind of server implementation. It's hard to find a solid one that works perfectly.
Mm.
So that could still be a problem, I think, but it's getting better and better.
Okay, so just something more to discuss before we take a break, I think. We should take 5 minutes, but after the break we will discuss other kind of architectures like the client-to-server, client-to-client, and the server-to-server communications. But I think we will take just 5 minutes break, and then we will continue with this one.
Yep. We're back.
Yep. So we talked about, those techniques that we just talked about is those client-to-server techniques, but there are other use cases as well, one being client-to-client. So if you and I are going to have a video call, it would be quite unnecessary to route this data
through a
server, which only will just proxy this one right out to the other client. So it would be really nice if we could have some kind of peer-to-peer communication as well. Even in games, could be, often you need to send the data to the server so that the server can control the state and make sure you don't cheat, because you always cheat. Yeah. So but there are many use cases where you need a peer-to-peer connection to the other client, and WebRTC is one of those techniques that has been developed over the past few years and is probably quite mature today to be able to use it. I'm not actually sure about the browser support.
I could look it up.
You look at that. But that is more or less a socket connection between two clients. And you can use this for video, for instance. And I think Mozilla and Google made the first live demo about this in 2013 or something like that. So it's been around for
Firefox and Chrome have good support, or
no support in Safari or Edge. That's pretty poor still.
Edge status in development, WebKit status in development. Yeah,
it will arrive sometime, but not pretty mature in Chrome and Firefox.
Yeah,
but not in,
and that's
in the
probably. Do you know any big application using WebRTC? Do you think of one?
I'm thinking about those like what's it called? It's called the one we are using for peer instructions. Discuss. Discord.
Discord.
I'm wondering if those like Slack as well, those web applications that have voice communication peer to peer. I wonder if they are using WebRTC. I'm not sure though. Could be easy to check out, but I haven't looked and heard. But
maybe they, because they have a desktop client written in web technologies, with the Electron framework, and that could be, because then you don't have the browser.
Yeah, in Electron you could probably use this, but they are also web applications that run in the browser. So maybe they use in WebRTC and in Edge and Safari, those functions will not work. I'm not sure. Or no. If they are being routed through the through.
But
the
it will take a couple of years. But when all the browsers are getting this support, you will probably see more applications.
Yeah, but you can read more about it in this link above. So we will not dwell.
Yeah, we will not go into it in this course, just so you know what it is and in what situation it could be used.
Yeah. However, in this course, we will look at server-to-server communication because that's an interesting case. So, I mean, of course, if you have two servers that need to communicate, of course, you can set up a WebSocket communication over those two servers if you like. Mm-hmm. If you are sending so much data back and forth, you could do that. However, in a normal case, you're only interested in like getting events.
Yeah, for
notifications when something happening on the other server.
Yeah.
And for that, we are using something called webhooks. And this will be pretty much used in the third assignment.
You will use it in the third assignment, yeah.
Mm.
So...
Yeah, so the scenario being this. Do we have a subscriber or the client, the client server in this case?
Yeah, someone who wants these notifications from another publisher.
Yeah, and this is called a subscriber in this model, and the publisher is the server publishing the data. So first of all, the subscriber need to notify the publisher that the subscriber want to subscribe to messages and what messages it wants to subscribe.
Yeah,
and this could be an automated process. It could be a manual process. Yeah. So this could be done in several different ways.
Yeah, many. If you check this webhooks often goes with a web API. You have the ability to have webhooks and the web. You can create them through the web API in kind of ways. You could also, as we will show, manually go into and telling, because you have to register a callback URL that you are taking responsibility over, so your application is listening on this callback URL, listening for post, HTTP post on this URL.
Yep. So when you're registering your application, you're registering a callback URL that the publisher will save together with a secret and information about what you are interested in this case, the event A.
You probably get some JSON document or XML or whatever.
And the publisher needs to save this, and as soon as something happens in our application, the publisher's application, it will go through its list of subscribers, look, okay, so those 20 subscribers is going to get this event, and it will send a post, as you said, to all of those subscribers on the callback URL.
So when we register the callback URL, we must make sure that we're listening to this callback URL and the post stuff. Yeah. And it should be one more error back to the publisher again, because you should answer with when you get the data with a 200 okay.
Yeah.
So the publisher will know. We will see in the examples.
Yeah.
So it's a very simple pattern, or what we call it, way to do it, but you can do a lot of things with it, I think. It's very interesting when services are making us able to register webhooks, because we can get so much notifications about other services.
Mm. And of course, I mean, you can implement this in any way you want. This is just a conceptual, subscriber publisher model, so you can implement this whatever you like. You can send an email to the publisher with the URL and the event and the callback URL and get a secret back over email, and then you have set up the communication. But there is a protocol called PubSub Hubhub.
That good name.
Was it Facebook?
It's Google.
Is it Google? Yeah, I think.
So
this is an open protocol for doing this distributed publish subscribe model.
Yeah.
So
we're not gonna go into that, but there is a way for having the whole ecosystem with a hub where you publish your what webhooks you can look at and stuff like that.
Yeah. Should we just have a look at how this is implemented in on GitHub? just to give an live example of this. So I'm inside of a repo on an organization on GitHub, but doesn't matter what kind of repo it is. But I use this because this has webhook pre-configured and has been used for a year or so. So going into settings on your repo, you will find this view and you will find webhooks. You can have webhooks on organizations on GitHub, or you can have webhooks, as in this case, on the repository. So in this case, we have set up a webhook going to CoursePress. So what this basically does is, as soon as we push something new to the syllabus, there will be a webhook going to CoursePress, telling CoursePress that there is new content in the syllabus, and CoursePress will cache this content so that we don't need to invoke GitHub for each and every request to get to CoursePress, because CoursePress is just mirroring the information on GitHub on for our course web pages. So yeah, but that's not important, but that is what it does. And this is our callback URL, basically. So going into this hook, we could have a look how it's set up. We see that, the content type that will be sent is application JSON.
Yeah.
We have a secret, so this secret is something that you need on both the client or the callback, the subscriber.
I have to be able to verify
that
this is called from GitHub in this case.
Yeah, so because now you have all seen this address, so you could, of course, start sending posts to this one. But since we are validating the requests with this secret, none of them will go through, basically. In this case, we are just interested in push events. So whenever someone pushes something new to this repository, we will send out an event. But you could pretty much fine-tune what you want to listen for. Yeah. So if someone is deleting something in this a branch or a tag in this repo, we will get a push for that, or get a hook for that. If someone is doing a release, for instance, if you guys are doing releases on your exam repos, we could have a hook listening for that and making sure that you are able to book oral hearing times, for instance.
Okay.
And whatever. But in this case, we're just listening for pushes. This one is an active webhook, and we can see here that it has been sending data to us on a regular basis.
And we have responded with 200 OK.
Yeah. So that's why we get a success.
Otherwise you will get a red cross over.
If it wasn't delivered.
And you can look at it if you want.
Yeah. So here you see the header for this message, and this is the payload. So this is what GitHub sends us. Information about, in this case, we got a message. This is the commit message, adding links to solutions. And we updated the exercises.md file. So, and of course, a lot of other information about who did the change, me apparently, and what the syllabus affected was in this organization. And a lot of information and issues, for instance.
Yeah, because this was about when pushes go through. So in the assignment, you will probably check in the issues.
Yep. Issues and then issue comments, because this is what you're
and then you have to analyze how do we get the data and picking the data you want. So you will do it on your own repository.
Yeah.
So you should be able to set up a webhook on that to your own application.
Yeah.
And there you will check in the assignment documentation how to handle the stuff when developing on localhost and how could it, because GitHub can't send to localhost, so you have to do stuff to have some proxy stuff, and the GitHub have some great documentation about this, so you have to do some read-up.
And of course, in this case, it's okay to set the webhook manually, even though you can set
of course,
the hook through the GitHub API. However, that's more interesting if you're doing a more general application where you can listen on all of your repos, for instance, and you make a OAuth authentication with a GitHub user or something like that. But in this case, it's okay to just hard code the webhook for your repository, your assignment repository. So taking this one step further, there are services today you have probably already heard of, if this and that. which is a service relying on hooks in many cases, or things like hooks. So this is more the user side of, I mean, setting up GitHub hooks and programming against it is you need to be a developer to be able to do this. But using services like If This Then That, this can everyone can use. Mm. It's quite simple. You use recipes where, for instance, keep your Facebook and Twitter profile pictures in sync. So this will authenticate against Facebook and Twitter, and then it will listen for hooks when this change, the picture change in the one of them, it will set the same image in the other one. So this is kind of an quite useful application, If This and That, that you could
change services together. And I think it's interesting to see what kind of things you can do.
Use this as an explorer to find ideas of things you can do. Because everything you find here, of course, you can do in code. So I mean, if you find an interesting recipe here, like saving screenshots to a separate iOS album, interesting, then you know you can do it in code because pretty much what this application does.
And this also is, you see, these kind of services, they have APIs. They have probably some kind of webhooks and stuff like that. And that's good to know when you are starting to create your own APIs. And don't forget to implement the functionality of having webhooks. It's a good thing.
Yep.
And you will probably use it in other kinds of, when you have internal system with different kind of application talking to each other, listening to notifications.
Yep. But webhooks being the starting point of the assignment, I think this is maybe the thing that you need to together with WebSockets.
Yeah, together with, the first thing I think will be contacting the web API, getting the current data.
Because this will only give us the changes.
And then when we have the, then we make some changes and we'll update the user. I have recorded a demo of my quickly solution, but that will show how the application, we think it will work some kind of way.
So, WebSockets in Node. We will show you a quick example of how to work with this in Node, but you should know, as in many occasions today, you will have even WebSockets as a service, so that you can use WebSockets in platforms like Firebase.
Maybe it won't be WebSockets all the time, but there are hosted solutions that give push technology so you don't implement it yourself on your own server, you're using a push technology as a service, or what we should call it. So there are different ways of doing that.
Yeah, but what's the fun in that when we're having a server course? So of course we are going to implement this.
But it's good to know if you're making the decision later on.
And I mean, one is not excluding the other. You can use this together with your application, of course. But we will focus on doing this in Node. And we don't have a native support in the Node for WebSockets like we have in the browser, where we have the WebSocket API built into the browser. In the Node, as you know,
we need
a module.
Yeah.
And the most popular module, I think, is Socket.
Yeah, I think so. It's one of the first thing, and they have both the server implementation and they have a optimized client library to it. The problem could be that it's pretty big. There are more optimized or more smaller packages that many suggest instead. But most of the solutions I worked with,
And this is both the client and the server library.
You get you download from their CDN. The client, and you pretty simple could connect to. Yeah. It's pretty like the it looks like the browser API.
Yeah, more or less.
More or less.
I'm not sure about this one. I haven't checked.
In the shot application we did in the last course, I think it was the WebSocket was implemented by this. Just to checking it out how it worked, but it's pretty simple. You could use it if you want.
Yeah, so this looks quite like the client. the client code.
Yeah.
So I think it's quite, if you're used to working with a client, this is quite
easy. It's a better solution than Socket.io.
However, Socket, we have I mean, for a real application, you have the fallback solution in Socket.io fallbacks on long polling.
They also implemented ways of have different rooms, so you can split up different channels in different rooms. You probably could do it in the other way also. But there are more modules to check up, more thinner or smaller or more optimized for that kind of application you're writing. So this, we just picked one of them.
Yeah. So just to show a simple chat with Socket.io and Express in parentheses. We're only using Express to show the static index file. But going back to that, we have, let's maximize that one as well. I think you could see this like that, maybe. It's good. I will try to stay out of the way. So let's look at the client first of all. So this is just a simple HTML page. Yeah. What we're doing is requiring the socket.io.
Yeah.
.js, you could do this from a CDN, I think.
Yeah, what it will, when you install Socket.io, it will create our own route where it will find this.
Yeah.
Or you could take it from a CDN. And then some inline scripting.
Yeah, we like this, doesn't we?
But it's easier to show this way.
Yeah, so this is a quick and dirty solution. Yeah. But this is pretty much just setting up a socket, doing some boring HTML and DOM stuff, you know the drill.
Yeah, we'll not go into it.
And then we are just listening for messages from the server that we have named, more or less. So we have named the messages. So this one is called welcome, new user, user left. So if we get a message from the server that says welcome, we will take take this action, adding a message with this data. We will actually do the same thing more or less in everyone, but
you can do it better.
Of course, you will have to do different things depending on what kind of message you get. You get new user, user left, chat messages. So this is basically just a simple chat.
Yeah.
Should we have a look at the functionality of that
you could
one?
Just show it.
Maybe we should start it as well. Like that, listening for 3000. Okay, so you have done a lot of styling on this one.
Yeah, as always.
Whoa. Start the chat. Welcome to the chat, Johan.
And you have to try it with different
so
browsers or tabs so you can check.
So this one is the start. Welcome to the chat test. I write something. Hello. It says that we get it and we got it on this side as well, and we saw the test has joined the chat, and the test says hello. And yeah, you know the drill. It's nothing strange going on.
So the data is going through the WebSocket connection in this case.
Yeah. So back to the server. We are, as I said, using Express more or less only
just
to
kicking it.
To get the index.html.
Yeah, and there are, you could, one thing to think about in the assignment is how to get the socket from the into the roots and stuff like that, and we're not showing this in this case, but there are several ways to do it, and you will probably
have to find out.
Yeah, you will find what you think is the best.
Yeah. So when we get the connection, we are listening for logins, for instance, and chat messages and so on. So
yeah, the IO on connection is when we're starting the WebSocket server, and inside that just doing setting different events happening when, in this case, the first login is called when a client
calls login.
Yeah,
or sends a message on login
connecting to the server.
Yeah, and that will happen when you, I guess, if you will have a look at that button, you have some kind of
the login.
What's it called?
I think you had it.
Wasn't there?
Socket emit login.
Yeah. So when you click the username button, you emit a message with a login name to the server, sending the username's value, and the server will get this
Yeah, it will listen to this event and something, and then you get
the data
and you can pick out the client's name.
And we create just a simple message, and we emit it. And when we emit it like this, on the socket.emit in this case, we will send it back to the connecting socket.
In when we have the socket object in this case, it's the special client.
Yeah. And socket.broadcast emit will send this to everyone except that user that sent it. You could also do it io.emit if you always want to send everything to all users.
Yeah, but in this case, we
differentiated between.
Yeah, exactly. And in the other case, we are listening to a chat message, and we let, if I'm sending the message, I'm listening for it back from the server to get a check that my message is coming through, so to say. So this is sending it on the IO object, emitting it will go to everyone connected.
Yep.
And you can make more complex stuff in Socket.io, having different rooms, so you have chat rooms or whatever, like some different kind of channels, which be more complicated, but the way it works.
You and in the assignment, you will probably find out that this is, you don't need to do this complicated.
Well, it's up to you
how many messages you want to send.
Yeah, the functionality you want, but you see that the main way to do it is pretty simple.
One thing to remember is that disconnect and connection, those two are reserved emitters. So don't
try to name your own name.
Because those will happen on when you get a connection, or in this case when a client disconnects. So if we close down, so in this case, remember how it looks. If I close this, you will see that immediately it will say in the remaining chat that the test user has left, and it's quite quick and
so
snappy, as you see.
Okay,
I'm doing this on local host.
But
that's pretty much it. A simple Socket.io example, and this is something you can do in your application.
Well,
we don't have. I mean, you could use whatever, but...
And the code will be on the course page to play around with.
And you have a demo as well, you said. Is it on... on Socket.
No more demos.
No, but you have a lot of demos about...
I have a demo of the application we should create in the assignment.
Yeah. But. So, I mean, it looks pretty simple, right? But, I mean... There are problems, browser support being one of those. However, I think if you're using Socket.io, you have like IE10 support, and that's pretty good, I think. We have concurrency problems with synchronization and stuff. And I mean, that's not a problem with sockets per se. That's
more the complications of the complex application. Depending on what kind of application. But that's... Yeah, that's always a problem, I would say.
You need to think about security. You need to think about using the TLS layer.
And we will force you to do it in the assignment.
Yep.
So you will use the VSS protocol instead of just the VS.
Yeah. But as we got a question about using notifications, for instance, and adding maybe installing a service worker for getting offline, to use an HTTPS connection. Yeah. Otherwise, you will not be able to install that service worker.
Yeah, and that's the next time. But in the production, we will say we will use something called a reverse proxy, setting up this sort of TSL stuff and handling this kind of things.
Offline is, we have discussed offline web applications before, but that's a problem as well with this kind of applications.
Yeah.
How will you handle if a user gets offline? Should it be able to freeze the state? Should it be able to add? I mean, we have discussed it. It's hard. It's a lot of things to consider when it comes to offline.
Mm. Yeah, especially when you got a lot of data.
Mm. Yeah.
So.
Yeah. So, but. It's pretty simple, as you will see. Right, that was that for today. Next time being not a lecture.
No.
Next time being a resource.
And they lecture. Are on the course page already, so you can start.
Dive in.
Yeah, that's not a problem. As we said, we come back to that. You have the ability, because you're going to publish the application on your own server, and here is a link to, yeah, you have it, the student developer pack that gives you different kinds of services you could use for a while, at least.
Yeah, you need to, but you all have, I think, you need to have your student email in the list of email addresses. On
okay.
I think, yeah. To be able to get this pack, because it's validated to the .lnus domain.
Exactly. So, yeah, exactly. And I think in the demos I will use the DigitalOcean service, where I can create virtual servers, and I will create a node server, and it will be the server where I put my application in production. So if you want, you could use that or another kind of virtual server, as long as you get some IP number or something, so we can see your application in public.
Yeah. So get started with the assignment as soon as you can.
Yeah, I think, because we put the oral exam forward a week, since we're going away this week. Mm. So
you should start
with this assignment
right now.
Yeah. I think
you should be finished with the second one already,
yeah,
more or less. Yeah, so I think that's that, actually. I have nothing more to add. Do we have any questions?
No, I don't think so.
I could have a look in live coding as well. Thank you. Someone asked our names. But there is actually no questions on live coding. Did we get any questions on Slack?
No. No.
Yeah, so now I'm actually excited to go out, look at the Swedish
Air
Force. I'm not sure if they're going over Växjö, but if they are, they should probably be there in like 10 minutes or so. So for those of you in Växjö, sorry, but for those of you in Kalmar, you should probably be able to see them soon, because it's a clear sky, so this will be exciting, I think.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that's all.
Yep, thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.